Random House Audio presents Divisadero by Michael Ondaatje. Read for you by Hope Davis. When I come to lie in your arms, you sometimes ask me in which historical moment do I wish to exist. And I will say Paris, the week Colette died. Paris, August 3rd, 1954. In a few days, at her state funeral, 1,000 lilies will be placed by her grave, and I want to be there, walking that avenue of wet lime trees until I stand beneath the second floor apartment that belonged to her in the Palais Royal. The history of people like her fills my heart. She was a writer who remarked that her only virtue was self-doubt. A day or two before she died, they say Colette was visited by Jean Genet, who stole nothing. Ah, the grace of the great thief. We have art, Nietzsche said, so that we shall not be destroyed by the truth. The raw truth of an incident never ends. And the story of Coop and the terrain of my sister's life are endless to me. They are the sudden possibility every time I pick up the telephone when it rings some late hour after midnight. And I wait for his voice or the deep breath before Claire will announce herself. For I have taken myself away from who I was with them and what I used to be when my name was Anna. Part 1. Anna, Claire, and Coop. The Orphan. By our grandfather's cabin, on the high ridge opposite a slope of buckeye trees, Claire sits on her horse, wrapped in a thick blanket. She has camped all night and lit a fire in the hearth of that small structure our ancestor built more than a generation ago, and which he lived in like a hermit or some creature when he first came to this country. He was a self-sufficient bachelor who eventually owned all the land he looked down onto. He married lackadaisically when he was 40, had one son, and left him this farm along the Petaluma Road. Claire moves slowly on the ridge above the two valleys full of morning mist. The coast is to her left. On her right is the journey to Sacramento and the delta towns such as Rio Vista, with its populations left over from the gold rush. She persuades the horse down through the whiteness alongside crowded trees. She has been smelling smoke for the last 20 minutes, and on the outskirts of Glen Ellen, she sees the town bar on fire. The local arsonist has struck early when certain it would be empty. She watches from a distance without dismounting. The horse, territorial, seldom allows a remount. In this, he can be fooled only once a day. The two of them, rider and animal, don't fully trust each other, although the horse is my sister Claire's closest ally. She will use every trick not in the book to stop his rearing and bucking. She carries plastic bags of water with her and leans forward and smashes them onto his neck so the animal believes it is his own blood and will calm for a minute. When Claire is on a horse, she loses her limp and is in charge of the universe. A centaur. Someday she will meet and marry a centaur. The fire takes an hour to burn down. The Glen Ellen Bar has always been the location of fights, and even now she can see scuffles starting up on the streets, perhaps to honor the landmark. She sidles the animal against the slippery redwood of a madrone bush and eats its berries, then rides down into the town, past the fire. Close by, as she passes, she can hear the last beams collapsing like a roll of thunder, and she steers the horse away from the sound. On the way home, she passes vineyards with their prehistoric-looking heat blowers that keep air moving so the vines don't freeze. 10 years earlier, in her youth, smudge pots burned all night to keep the air warm. Most mornings, we used to come into the dark kitchen and silently cut thick slices of cheese for ourselves. My father drinks a cup of red wine. Then we walk to the barn. Coop is already there, raking the soiled straw, and soon we are milking the cows, our heads resting against their flanks. A father, his 2 11-year-old daughters, and Coop, the hired hand, a few years older than us. No one has talked yet. There's just been the noise of pails or gates swinging open. Coop in those days spoke sparingly in a low-pitched monologue to himself, as if language was uncertain. Essentially, he was clarifying what he saw. The light in the barn, where to climb the approaching fence, which chicken to cordon off, capture, and tuck under his arm. Claire and I listened whenever we could. Coop was an open soul in those days. We realized his taciturn manner was not a wish for separateness, but a tentativeness about words. He was adept in the physical world where he protected us, but in the world of language, he was our student. At that time, as sisters, we were mostly on our own. Our father had brought us up single-handed and was too busy to be conscious of intricacies. He was satisfied when we worked at our chores and easily belligerent when it became difficult to find us. Since the death of our mother, it was Coop who listened to us complain and worry, and he allowed us the stage when he thought we wished for it. Our father gazed right through Coop. He was training him as a farmer and nothing else. What Coop read, however, were books about gold camps and gold mines in the California Northeast, about those who had risked everything at a riverbend on a left turn and so discovered a fortune. By the second half of the 20th century, he was, of course, 100 years too late. But he knew there were still outcrops of gold in rivers, under the bunch grass, or in the pine sierras. There was a book, not much more than a pamphlet with a white spine, I found high on a shelf in the mudroom of the farm. Interviews with Californios, women from early times to the present. As most of those women did not write, archivists from Berkeley had traveled with tape recorders to capture these lives and the ambience of the past. The monograph included accounts dating from the early 1800s to the present, from the dictation of Doña Eulalia to the dictation of Lydia Mendez. Lydia Mendez was our mother. It was here in this book that we discovered the woman who had died the week Claire and I were born. Only Coop, among the three of us, who'd worked on the farm since he was a boy, had known her as someone alive. For Claire and me, she was a rumor, a ghost rarely mentioned by our father, someone interviewed for a few paragraphs in this book and shown in a washed-out black-and-white photograph. All the people in the book had a humility, a sense that history was around them, not within them. We grew up in the Central Plain, northeast of Los Angeles, where my father worked the asphaltum pits. I married when I was 18, and that night we danced so many times to La Vuquilla and El Grullo. The violin players and guitarists, my husband said, were the best in the region. The trestle table with food was set up by the great rock in the pasture. My husband's father landed 30 years earlier in San Francisco, and the same day, I am told, he caught the steamer to Petaluma and built this house. By the time I arrived here, there were 1,000 laying hens. But my husband did not want others working on the farm, so we kept only dairy cattle and grew corn. Foxes were killing the hens, and it took too much trouble to protect them. There were other animals in the hills, bobcats and coyotes, rattlesnakes in the redwoods. I saw a mountain lion once, but the devil's curse was thistles. We fought to cut them back. The neighbors never did it right, and their thistle seeds flew onto our property. There was a man further down the Petaluma Road who had 100 goats, a gentle man. Sometimes he came and camped with his goats in our fields. A special small goat that ate thistles, and its digestion killed the seed. Somehow it chewed the seed up properly. A cow doesn't do that. A cow eats thistles and the seed goes right through. If you hate thistles, you could have loved this man. There was a terrible violence on the farm next to ours. The Cooper family was killed by a hired hand who beat them to death with a wooden board. At first, no one knew who had committed such an act, but their son had hidden in the crawl space under the floorboards of the house for several days. He was 4 years old and he came out eventually and told who had done it. We took the boy in to stay and work on the farm. This is all of the portrait we own of our mother. Whatever else she might have considered and thought remains in an unquestioned distance. She had spoken mostly of events that stumbled against her, so we had only her affection for the goatman, her brief joy in dancing, the details of the murder on the neighboring farm that brought Coop into our household. There is nothing revealed here about her pleasures or her intelligence or her compassion. Things that must have been a guiding star for our father. Just 2 pages about this Californio, who would die in childbirth when she was 23. What is not in the small white book, therefore, is the strange act of our father during the chaos surrounding her death, when he took on informally the adoption of a child from the same hospital where his wife was giving birth, the daughter of another mother who had also died, bringing both children home and raising the other child, who had been named Claire, as his own. So there would be 2 girls, Anna and Claire, born the same week. People assumed that both were his daughters. This was our father's gesture that grew from Lydia Mendez's passing. The dead mother of the other child had no relatives, or was a solitary. Perhaps that was how he was able to do this. It was a field hospital on the outskirts of Santa Rosa, and to put it brutally, they owed him a wife. They owed him something. Now and then, our father embraced us as any father would. This happened only if you were able to catch him in that no man's land between tiredness and sleep, when he seemed wayward to himself. I joined him on the old covered sofa, and I would lie like a slim dog in his arms, imitating his state of weariness. Too much sun, perhaps, or too hard a day's work. Claire would also be there sometimes, if she did not want to be left out or if there was a storm. But I simply wished to have my face against his checkered shirt and pretend to be asleep, as if inhaling the flesh of an adult.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.